So let us look at intensity transformations and spatial filtering in digital image processing. So this intensity transformation and spatial filtering which we are going to see today. So operation takes place in the spatial domain. The operations, there are two domains basically. One is the spatial domain in which we deal or we treat the image as rows and columns, like a matrix, while there is another domain which is called the frequency domain. You will see, you will be knowing about Fourier transform shortly. So that Fourier transform transforms the image from spatial domain to frequency domain. So that is another domain. So there are two domains in which we can work. So these are the operations, intensity transformation and spatial filtering basics. Or spatial filtering, these are the operations which takes place in spatial domain. Okay, it operates directly on pixels values because you have a grid value like what is there in matrix, in the matrix form. So often more computationally efficient and require less resources as far as these operations are concerned. General form of this operation is the result is gxy if some transformation is applied on our image, that is fxy. This fxy is the input image, this gxy is the output image, and t is the operator on f defined over a neighborhood of point xy. So these are somewhat neighborhood operations only. So intensity operations and spatial filtering, let us continue this. The operator can apply to a single image or a set of images. Okay, it can apply to a single image or a set of images. The point xy shown is an arbitrary point in the image. You can take any point, right? The region containing the point is a neighborhood of xy. This region containing this point y is a neighborhood of xy. So typically, this is 3 by 3 neighborhood of xy. This 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this area, this region which we have shown by 3 by 3 matrix or boxes are actually the neighborhood of xy. So typically the neighborhood of is rectangular, centered in xy. This is centered at xy and it's much smaller than the image. So this is a sub part of image. You can take 5 by 5 also and 7 by 7 also. So spatial filtering generally involves operation over the entire image. So operation takes place involving pixels within a neighborhood of a point of interest xy like this. It also involves predefined operation called a spatial filter. And these spatial filters are predefined. The values, the weights of these fixed filters are predefined because they have already been tested, checked, verified. So this spatial filter is commonly, they are commonly referred to as spatial mass kernel template or window. So where whichever word any book is using, the meaning remains the same, that is spatial mask, kernel, template and window. So what is the point processing? The smallest neighborhood of a pixel is 1 by 1 in size. So here g depends only on the value of f, x, x, y. G is the result, f is the original image, you must remember. So t becomes an intensity transformation of the form tr, right? This r, this s and r represent the intensity of g and f at any point xy. So this is the transformation of the intensity, also called the gray level or mapping function. So what it does is, this is, I'm giving a intensity transformation example. This particular thing is contrast stretching function, and this one is our thresholding function. This is contrast stretching. This is dark, this is light. This is dark, this is light. So if you just tend to increase this curve like this, maybe to this, or maybe to more to this, there are certain changes which are going to take place. In a similar fashion, because you have in this threshold function, you have just wanted that at from below this point, everything will be dark. And from below, above this point, everything will be light. This is the thresholding function. is our intensity transformation function. So here T is a transformation that maps a pixel value R into the pixel value of S, that is the resultant value, resultant image. Since we are concerned with digital data, the transformation can generally be implemented with a simple lookup table. So there are three types of transformation. First of all, we have linear, that is negative or identity transformation. We have logarithmic, means log and inverse log transformation. And we have power law, that is nth power or nth root transformation. These are the three basic transformations as far as intensity transformation functions are concerned. So this is general form of basic intensity transformation. If this is output intensity, this is input intensity. This is the identity function. If nothing happens, this is the identity function. If you say that I want to make my image negative, then this is the function. This is the negative. This is inverse log. This is nth power. This is nth power. This is log, right? This is nth root, sorry. Nth power and inverse log, and this is nth root and log. So this is how your intensity varies. So the negative of an image with intensity levels in the form of 0 to L minus 1. This can be described as you take the highest value, L, and you subtract this L minus 1. This is L minus 1, highest value. And you subtract this R from this highest value. Means if it is from 0 to 255, okay, the gray levels are ranging from 0 to 255, then what you will do is, you are going to deduct, say, 140 is the value, brightness value of some pixel. You subtract 140 from this. Say some value is 120. So you subtract 120 from 255. Subtract 120 from 255. This is how you will get the negative image. So the original digital mammogram is shown here. This is a negative image obtained using the negative transformation. In equation, this, you know, this is one of the equation that can be used like this. And these are the log transformation. General form is S is equal to C log 1 plus R. C is any constant. R is greater than or equal to 0. It maps a narrow range of low intensity value in input to a wider output range. Okay. If this intensity, for example, this is the intensity. All the intensities lie here only. Low intensities are there. So what it will do, it will map it to a higher range. It will map it to higher range. So the opposite is true for high intensity value. If high intensity values are there, it can be mapped to a lower intensity values of narrow range. It can be compressed to a narrow range. So compresses the dynamic range of image with large variation in pixel values. This is a log transformation. This is a plot or an image of the Fourier spectrum. This Fourier spectrum is enhanced usually for a fairly high dynamic range. So this is, we are going to learn about Fourier spectrum, because now we are not in digital spatial domain, that is no row and column version. Now we are in the frequency domain. Okay, we are in the frequency domain. So the image can be enhanced by applying the log transformation. This is the Fourier transform, and the result of applying the log transformation is given by this with C equal to 1, and we have used this expression only. Now power law, this is the gamma transformation. This is the basic form. S is equal to C R to the power gamma, where C and gamma are constants. We are only dependent on S and R. R is the input, S is the result. So power law curves with fractional values of this gamma map a narrow range of dark input values to a wider range of output values. Again, the same thing is happening, and the opposite is true for higher values of input values. So there exists a family of possible transformation curved by varying gamma. You just vary gamma and you will get that, okay, we our image is not being taken properly, we have a narrow range. It can go to, it can, you know, you can stretch it to a higher range. This is the power law transformation curve. We are using S is equal to C into R to the power gamma for various values of this gamma. See, all curves were scaled to fit in the range shown. This is the range 0 to L minus 1. This is the highest, means it may be any value, like or multiple of value, twice 2 to the power of any gray level value. So these are the various gamma you can see. And now gamma correction, many devices used for image capture, display and printing respond according to power law. So the exponent in the power law equation is referred to as gamma, which we just saw. So the process of correcting for the power law response is referred to as gamma correction. For example, in CRT devices, they have an intensity to voltage response that is a power function. Exponentially, typical range from 1.8 to 2.5, that is gamma. And gamma correction in this case would be achieved by applying the transformation if you take this gamma as 0.4. Okay, this is the original image, right? This is the gamma correction. This is the gamma corrected image. This is the original image as viewed on monitor. And this is the gamma corrected image as viewed on the monitor, same monitor. See, what is the difference? You know, there is a huge difference. This A is the intensity ramp image and B is the image as viewed on the simulated monitor with the gamma of 2.5. And C, this is the gamma corrected image, and this is D, this is the corrected image as viewed on the same monitor. You can see, compare this B and D, how different they are. And just an simple operation, image processing operation has changed entire view of the output. Now this A, this is a magnetic, again gamma correction we are talking, MRI example is there. This is a magnetic resonance MRI of a fractured human spine. And this B and D, this results applying a transformation of equation we have just known. With C equal to 1, gamma equal to 0.6 and 0.4. This is 0.6, this is 0.4 and 0.3 respectively. So you can see here huge difference, huge viewing, you know, pleasing aesthetically view of, and moreover you can extract information as well. These are the aerial example. So A, this is the aerial image. This B and D are result, you know, applying the transformation with C equal to 1 and gamma equal to 3, 4 and 5. So you can see that this is gamma, this is another gamma, this is another gamma. You have used 3, 4 and 5. And what a huge improvement, because here all fog is there. You just can see everything if you just apply a simple gamma correction. Then we turn to piecewise linear transformation. Piecewise function can be arbitrary complex. A disadvantage is that their specification requires significant user input. For example, we have various piecewise linear transformation like contrast stretching, intensity level slicing and bit plane slicing. Contrast stretching, it expands the range of intensity value in an image, so it spans over a full intensity range. If you have a range from 0 to 255 and the intensity levels are only between 120 or say 180. So we map 120 to 0, we map 180 to 0, 180 to 255. So now we are using the full range of full intensity range. So control point R1S1 and R2S2 control the shape of the transform TR. This is TR, this is R1S1, this is R2S2. So R1 is equal to R2, we make R1 equal to R2, S1 equal to 0, this S1 equal to 0 we make, and this S2 we make as L-1. So we stretch it to whole, because this is just, these two points are only using this much area of the full intensity range. What we are doing is, we are stretching it to the whole range. This is the image, and see what, how improved these images are just by simple contrast switching. Then we have intensity level stretching. This is used to highlight a specific range of intensity in an image that might be of interest, right? This is not highlighting total intensity, just a specific range of intensity which we are interested in. So two common approaches are: set all pixel value within a range of interest to one value, white, and all others to black. This produces a binary image. While you can brighten or darken pixel value in the range of interest and leave all other unchanged. Okay. So this is transformation highlights this particular transformation is highlights intensity range A to B. This A to B and reduces all other intensity to a lower value. This has reduced to the lower value. And this particular transformation, what it does is, this transformation highlights range A to B. This is highlight, and it has preserves all other intensity levels. So these are the two ways you can achieve intensity level slicing. So as you see the example, this is an image. This is the result of using a slicing transformation of type illustrated in figure this one. And this is how you can this version. Okay, just highlighting or brightening pixel values of range of interest. This is the second version. So the first version, second version. So it depends on your use or your result, what you want to do. This is intensity level slicing. Now coming to bit plane slicing, pixels are digital values composed of bits as we know it. For example, a pixel is in a 256 level grayscale image is comprised of 8 bits. 2 to the power 8, 8 is 256. So we can highlight the contribution made to total image appearance by specific bits. For example, we can display an image that only shows the contribution of specific bit plane. This is bit plane 1, this is bit plane 8, this is least significant, this is most significant. This is 8 byte bit. So this is bit plane slicing. This is an 8 bit grayscale image of some size, 500 by 1192. This is bit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. These are the various bit images, different bit images. So each bit plane is a binary image, and you see this is the most contributing. This bit is the most contributing. So if we want to delete or you want to see any particular bit image, you can see. So this bit plane slicing is useful if in determining the number of bits necessary to quantize an image, because you may need only few bits. Why to use more number of bits? Because it will give rise to more size also. And image compression, this is most important. Image reconstructed using bits 7 and 8, which we just saw, only 7 and 8. This is the image, 7 and 8, 8. This is 8, 7, 6, 7, 8, and this is 5, 6, 7, 8. There are not much difference, but still, you can get the image without loss of the viewing, or you can please them, or you can appreciate them. So this was a bit idea about image processing aspects. Thank you so much. Take care.